Good morning. Thank you for coming to today's retired racehorse meeting. My name is Robert Williams, and I work with the commission. Last year, with the significant assistance of Jack Knowlton, commission staff conducted its first retired racehorse summit. Those of you who were present last year know the story. Jack came to my office in Schenectady, and through the report from the New York Task Force on Retired Racehorses, on my desk, Knowlton, who had served on the task force, asked but a single question: what have you done lately? It was a good question because the issue of health and safety of horses was so important to the members of the Gaming Commission that they included that sentiment in our mission statement. In fact, the commission and its predecessor have long professed that responsible stewardship of the horse includes factoring in the entire life cycle and ensuring that these athletes have viable options once their racing careers are over. To that end, we have brought actions against racing licenses of owners who have neglected their horses or otherwise mistreated their charges. Commission involvement in aftercare is a bit of a conundrum in that our jurisdiction over a racehorse ends when it leaves training and is retired. While the commission has little ability to drive revenue to retirement programs, we do, however, have an ability to raise profile on this important subject. I think we were somewhat successful last year by hosting the forum, which served to highlight issues that surround racehorse aftercare, identify and highlight some of the positive things that have occurred in the past 3.5 years at that time since the task force issued its report, and tried to identify some of the challenges and solutions to promoting responsible aftercare. Since last year's meeting, Jack, Lee Park, and I have met on numerous occasions to discuss the status of some research that we started, trying to identify the location of New York-bred horses that have left the racetrack, and to discuss a project that we think will also raise awareness. I was going to start off with the screening of this, but I do want to make a particular delegation of the microphone to someone here, because he's got a lot of different things to do. As you know, we're in the tail end of the Saratoga racing season. But last year, we had the director of racing operations from NYRA, Martin Panza, come, and he said that NYRA, or committed NYRA, to a $5 per start to the Thoroughbred Aftercare Alliance, subject to board approval. Since then, the board has approved that commitment and has commenced that process. Today, we've upgraded Martin a little, and we have the president and chief executive officer of the New York Racing Association, who would like to make a very quick a couple of remarks relative to aftercare. Mr. Chris Kay?
Thank you, Rob. Thank you. Thank you very much. You know, it's very nice of you to give me applause, but when we started this meeting, Rob just started speaking. I think we all want to express our appreciation for a job extremely well done day in and day out by Rob Williams. And I doubt that Martin would think of this as an upgrade. But thank you for inviting me to speak here and for letting me do it at this point in time. I also want to mention that Joe Lambert, our general counsel and chief administrative officer, as well as Bill McCarthy, one of our attorneys, are both here today and will be here for the duration of this meeting. I want to mention three NYRA initiatives to support racehorse aftercare programs. As Rob just mentioned, on the September 1st, 2015 New York State Gaming Commission Summit on Racehorse Aftercare, NYRA committed to donate $5 per start at its three tracks to the Thoroughbred Aftercare Alliance, the TAA. NYRA is proud to partner with the TAA, a not-for-profit organization with whom we share a common goal: to create sustainable funding for accredited thoroughbred aftercare organizations, including specifically those in New York. The organizations in New York that are accredited by the TAA are the Akindale Thoroughbred Rescue in Pawling, Equine Advocates in Chatham, Finger Lake Thoroughbred Adoption Program in Farmington, the Retirement Assistance and Care for Equines, or RACE, Fund in Goshen, Old Friends in Greenfield Center, and Rerun here in this area. and there may be two others that are under consideration right now. Funding, or lack of it, has been a consistent theme of racehorse aftercare, but there has been universal praise for the TAA's grant-based model for accredited organizations. So, as part of NIRA's 2016 budget, the NIRA Reorganization Board committed to matching contributions to the TAA in 2016, $5 per start. As of this point in time, we have paid $41,250 to the TAA, and we expect to pay approximately $80,000 to $100,000 by year's end. NIRA's commitment is in line with that of other organizations. In 2014, NYTHA, led by Rick Violette, began contributing $5 per start. In 2015, Keeneland and Churchill Downs began matching donations to the TAA with the Kentucky Horsemen's Benevolent and Protective Association. So we are committed to funding, and that is one of the important initiatives. But in addition to funding, we also try to shine a bright light on aftercare charities. The community outreach booth, which is located next to the Jockey Silk Room and across from the Saratoga Walk of Fame, provides one not-for-profit organization per day with an exclusive opportunity to interact with our many thousands of guests who visit the Saratoga Racecourse. They're able to share information about their work and to host fundraising initiatives that day. And every organization that has utilized this opportunity has been extremely pleased with the results. In 2015, five Thoroughbred Aftercare charities appeared at the Saratoga Racecourse community outreach booth, including the Aftercare Continued Thoroughbred Training, or ACT Naturally, Heading for Home, Old Friends at Cabin Creek, Rerun Thoroughbred Adoption, and the Thoroughbred Retirement Foundation. This year, we have hosted the Thoroughbred Aftercare Alliance, the Akindale Thoroughbred Rescue, and the Thoroughbred Retirement Foundation in our community outreach booth, and we will host Rerun Thoroughbred Adoption again this year on September 2nd. Third way we try to assist the cause is by participating in the Hampton Classic Horse Show. We announced earlier this year that our intention is to match all prize money won by American Thoroughbreds on opening day, including all local hunter division, the $10,000 Martyrs Local Hunter Derby, and the $30,000 Speed Challenge. Now, a horse is considered local if it has been stabled on Long Island at least 75 days since January 1st. A jockey club certificate, letter of identification, lip tattoo, or tip card is accepted proof of breed. So the purpose behind this partnership is to promote the breed and incentivize people so that thoroughbreds can have a second career after the racetrack. So those are the three ways we have tried to respond to the question and to last year's conference. First, funding, anywhere from $80,000 to $100,000 this year. Second, by enhancing public awareness. And third, by promoting a second career for these wonderful equine athletes. Thank you all very much for your support and for permitting me to speak at this time.
Thank you very much, Chris. We really appreciate NIRA's attention to this this issue. I think it's really important that the racetracks in New York State take the opportunities that they have to do something for aftercare and recognize that the horses are just not there for a limited amount of time but need to be taken care of and addressed over the course of their lifetime. Again, I really appreciate you taking time out of your busy schedule on that. What I plan on doing here is with Lee Park's assistance, we're going to first start with an awareness item that I had mentioned that we've been working on. Then Jack is going to run through what he's learned and what we've learned and how we've attempted to locate these retired New York breds. And then after Jack, I think what's most appropriate is to open this up to discuss ideas and concepts for the upcoming year. You know, as I mentioned on several occasions, retired racehorses is not a government solution. There's not a government solution for it, but we can help. We can help raise awareness. We can do a variety of different things. And I'm really looking to get ideas from the interested parties here as to where we can help. And I think that the last part of our conversation will be that. And that'll be partially moderated by Peter Machete, who is one of our gaming commissioners, who is also a resident of Saratoga Springs. Well, last year we announced that the commission will be requiring all applicants who are an owner or trainer's licenses or license renewals verify that they have watched a short video about aftercare responsibilities that will be embedded in the commission's website. We've been internally developing this production for some time, and we have a concept that there's going to be ultimately two versions. One is a long-form video that will go into some depth regarding aftercare and some of the challenges that it faces. The other will be a short-term video that licensees and the prospective licensees will have to watch, as I mentioned, in order to get a racing license or a renewal, beginning with calendar year 2017. It's not much, but it's a start in raising and, in turn, we hope, getting people to accept responsibility for the animals in this industry that have given us so much enjoyment. So I think what we're going to do today is we're going to screen the first cut of the longer video. I do want to mention that we have Stacy Clark Rogers on the phone, so if you hear a disembodied voice coming from the lectern, that's her. She's the executive director of the Thoroughbred Aftercare Alliance. She couldn't be here today in person, but she certainly wanted to participate, and we appreciate that. Lee?
New York State horse racing is among the best in the world, the best owners and trainers, the best jockeys and drivers, the best venues and fans, and, of course, the best horses. Hi, I'm Larry Colmas, track announcer for the New York Racing Association, and I'd like to show you how we take care of these horses in New York. The horse racing industry is like no other. People from all over the world strive to be a part of this storied tradition, and once they experience it, they're often hooked.
I got into it because I really liked drinking and gambling, and that was the beginning of it, and I thought if I went to find out more about horses, I would become a better gambler. That wasn't true. I apprenticed myself out to a bottom claiming trainer at Suffolk Downs and worked there for 2 years every morning. And before I went to my regular job as a writer for the Boston Globe, I would go to Barn 7 at Suffolk Downs every morning at 7 o'clock. I'd get there by 7 o'clock and work until 8:30, and then go to the Globe. It was like I had this secret identity. And then, as luck would have it, it didn't improve my handicapping at all, but I totally fell in love with the horses.
Michael Blowen founded Old Friends in 2003 as a retirement home for thoroughbred horses. Today, his facilities in Kentucky and Saratoga Springs are home to more than 160 horses whose racing days are behind them.
These are great athletes, and they deserve everything that we can possibly give them, whether they're racing or whether they're retired.
Old Friends is just one of several viable places where horses can go once their racing days are over. Organizations across New York work together to ensure horses have opportunities for second careers, private adoption, or retirement at safe facilities, all with the goal of promoting responsible retirement and aftercare of racehorses. Part of the responsibility of the owner, trainer, and other connections is to understand the life cycle of the horse. Racehorses are foaled, raised, trained, and begin their racing careers by the age of 2. They have an average lifespan of 30 years, most of which occur well after their racing careers end. The first year of a racehorse's life is referred to as the foal or weanling stage. At 1 year of age, they advance to the yearling stage, where training begins. By the age of 2, both thoroughbreds and standardbreds are racing. The thoroughbred, on average, races until the age of 7, while a standardbred usually races until the mandatory retirement age of 15. 15 to 23 years of a racehorse's life is spent off the track. But during the horse's racing career, diet, nutrition, and physical health are crucial and closely monitored by professionals. Horses are typically given small meals throughout the day to reduce risk of colic and ulcers. The skeleton of the horse is tracked regularly by use of diagnostic imaging to help catch early injuries and growth defects. Attention to the condition of tendons, bones, and joints is monitored extensively during and after training to ensure the horse's safety and health. Part of being a responsible horse owner is simply being involved.
You know, learn about how to really take care of this horse. Plus, it increases your enjoyment of the sport. You know, if you're just going to the races on Saturday and hope to get your picture taken in a winner's circle, that's a lot of fun. It is. It's only happened to me a couple of times, but it's really, really a lot of fun. But even more than that, it's fun to come to the barn in the morning, see the horse. You know, you might irritate the trainer a little, but that's all right. He's your horse. Irritate the trainer.
Speaking of trainers, Nick Zito is a Hall of Fame trainer and lifelong New Yorker who goes extra lengths to ensure horses under his care end up in safe places after they leave the track.
Yeah, I think a racehorse is not only a personal investment, a financial investment, but it's definitely a personal investment.
Nick Stable employs a unique approach. He puts stickers on the foal papers identifying his stable so that future owners have somewhere to turn to make sure the horse ends up in a safe home.
People don't understand sometimes. They think, well, I bought the horse. I didn't do any good. I didn't get lucky, like they say. It's a bad investment, so be it. Well, that's not the case. You know, where do those animals go? What happens? You know, it's a breathing, living thing. It's not machinery. Most people tell you, when you're in business, I have a piece of machinery, it doesn't work, I get rid of it. Well, you have, again, you know, I'll say it a million times, a personal problem.
Jack Knowlton of Saratoga Stables, which owns Kentucky Derby winner Funnyside, worked on a state task force to study where horses end up after racing.
There really was not any thought that was being given to what happened to horses that didn't make it on a racetrack or didn't continue their racing career. For one thing, standardbreds can race until they're 14 years old, and you have a lot of standardbreds that are racing until they're 9 or 10 or older. We had a situation back when I was involved that there were an awful lot of times where horses would just leave. People would pay $300, $500 for them, and we forgot about it. Things have changed a lot now, and I think particularly on the thoroughbred side, it's an awful lot of interest and commitment on the part of the industry to make sure that there are no bad endings for the thoroughbreds.
As more attention has been brought to equine aftercare, more resources have come with it. For smaller aftercare operations, however, it's all hands on deck to take care of these retired athletes. Kelly Holt from Sunshine Horses in central New York fully understands this.
It takes a village, a town, and a city. We are 100% volunteer-based. We have approximately about 75 to 100 active volunteers, and when I say active volunteers, they're the ones that come in morning and afternoon when it's 100 out, 20 below zero, to do the feeding and to do the mucking of the stalls. Our actual email volunteer list is about 350.
For these farms to succeed, they need help from within and beyond the industry.
We get a lot of our monthly money on sponsorships. And when I say sponsorship is that certain horses have sponsors that pay from $75 to $200 a month for the care of that animal. And that's where we get a majority of it. We do get, especially around Christmas time, a lot of people give in-kind gifts to Sunshine. We do fundraising. We're having a huge annual open house, and we do get a lot of money from there. And the tracks do support us somewhat. But everything is basically mom and dad writing checks for, you know, birthday parties that are here. And I write checks. I sponsor a horse monthly. And that's where we get a lot of our revenue. Nothing else comes but 100% donations.
Lisa Malloy manages Rerun Thoroughbred Adoption in East Greenbush, where they retrain, rehome, and put up for adoption retired horses.
Even if you send the horse with just $200 or $300, it's better than running the horse into the ground. And there is such a variety of programs, and I think each one serves its own niche market. There are programs for older war horses, there are programs for broodmares, there are programs for permanent sanctuaries, and then there's programs like us that retrain and rehabilitate for second careers. So there's plenty of options out there, but for those options to be viable and continue to be viable, they do need funding and they do need the support. And to encourage members of the public to invest further in these horses in second careers, you have to have viable horses to go on and do something.
So how can one plan for this? Owners of racehorses should be prepared to contribute to a horse's aftercare. Think of it as a pension plan for the horse.
The first thing that you should do is start a Social Security or a 401k for your horse. Put away a little, all the money you have. When they go to the sale and they've got all the money's flowing now, the horse is 2 years old, they're excited, this is their derby prospect, everybody's going in, let's go. They're bidding a lot of money on these really well-bred horses. Just take a little bit of that and put it away.
Andy Belfiore and Rich Schossberg run the Take the Lead and Take Two second career programs at the New York Racing Association tracks, including Belmont, Aqueduct, and Saratoga. To support their and others' efforts, many sales companies, individual tracks, and other organizations that collect fees from owners and trainers in turn contribute to aftercare organizations.
Whether they know it or not, everybody who's involved in owning a thoroughbred is feeding into this pension plan. And they can do over and above that, too, for an individual. Plus, they can also make, you know, they're all 501c3s. Nothing wrong with writing a check, you know, at the end of the year, and you want to make a donation to a charitable organization, and you get the tax deduction also.
For thoroughbreds, one of the most significant recent developments has been the establishment of the Thoroughbred Aftercare Alliance, or TAA. This nonprofit makes sure that organizations taking in horses are safe and have adequate resources to properly care for them.
They accredit the organization so that you know that the organization you're working with is doing everything right. From their financials to the state of their facility to how they care for the horses, everything is done to, you know, best that can be done.
Thoroughbred Aftercare Alliance has done a tremendous job raising awareness, raising money. Their accreditation process is like getting audited by the IRS. It's a very, very tough procedure, but they've helped racing more in the last couple of years than any other organization, including ours. They've done a tremendous job.
The TAA also brings much-needed cohesion to the issue of aftercare and fairly distributes donated funds to accredited organizations.
The other thing the TAA's done that's really remarkable is they've gotten all these groups that were disparate, that were all fighting for the same money and fighting for the same funds and telling the same stories, and they got us all to work together, and that was a tremendous feat.
So, besides contributing money to accredited organizations, what more can we as an industry do to take care of these animals? Turns out, quite a lot.
The responsible thing is to certainly make sure the horse comes first. They don't overrace it. They try not to. And when a horse does have a problem, or it gets, let's say, in the claiming race, which obviously a lot of horses can't run in, you know, superior races, high-class races, you know, stake races, they follow them. They follow them. That's the responsibility. That's the personal responsibility. They follow them.
When it comes time for a horse to move on to a new owner or an aftercare facility, good veterinary records are essential, not only to protect the horse, but to also prevent unnecessary treatments or tests.
Tell us exactly what you know about the horse. We only what was in the best interest of the horse to begin with. So you being completely honest with us with what its injury was or what its problems were is only going to help us get that horse either a sanctuary or the right home.
Of course, part of the responsibility we all share is to know about the various programs both in and beyond New York State. From placement programs like Take the Lead and Take Two, to temporary retraining and rehoming facilities like New Vocations and Rerun, to full retirement farms and sanctuaries like Old Friends and Equine Advocates, to adoption centers such as the Finger Lakes Thoroughbred Adoption Program, Akindale Thoroughbred Rescue, and Sunshine Horses, there are many great organizations and people dedicated to finding good homes for the horses that do so much for all of us. The New York Thoroughbred Horsemen's placement programs, Take the Lead and Take Two, are integral to the state's efforts to find second homes and careers for former racehorses. They work with TAA-accredited facilities to place horses and raise funds.
Our program, Take the Lead, does not require an owner or a trainer to donate,
right,
because we want to encourage as much participation as possible. That said, for the most part, the owners and trainers have been very generous in donating.
Yeah.
But we don't want that to be a deterrent to say, oh, I can't afford, or, you know, whatever. You come to us, one-stop shopping,
right,
we'll find the horse a placement, and if you can donate, that's fantastic.
Akindale Thoroughbred Rescue is located on 1,000 acres of pristine land in Pawling, on the estate of legendary horseman John Hettinger.
Yes, we welcome people to come, and they can come and visit and learn the history of Akindale and just see the facility and how well the horses look and how well they're taken care of, and, you know, maybe they'll look to adopt a horse.
Up the road in East Greenbush is Rerun, a retraining and adoption center that, along with new vocations, works closely with NYTHA's Take the Lead and Take Two programs.
We average around 100 horses a year that we try to take in. Our main intake is directly from the track, either via the New York Horseman program or from trainers directly. Occasionally we do buy horses from auctions and through kill buyer broker programs. And preferably the horses are under the age of 12 and have to have at least some prospect of becoming a second career riding horse, whether it be trail or as an upper level prospect. We do a lot of rehab, we do a lot of surgical cases, and we, you know, 75 to 100 horses a year, we probably place in excess of 65 in homes. And we also maintain a permanent sanctuary herd.
The Finger Lakes Thoroughbred Adoption Program is a unique operation given its location. Founder Wanda Policini established the facility out of a long-standing concern for the care of the animals.
It's great. It is great to be able to lead your horse from the backside over here. That's one of the best things about our program, and we are still the only one that's located on the physical racetrack.
Old Friends is a showcase for responsible horse retirement. The residents here, many of them famous thoroughbreds, are truly retired and spend their days enjoying the pasture.
We've had horses go through our farm that are in the Hall of Fame here in Saratoga. Precisionist, for example, we had him in his final days, and we're really pleased to have him. He's the last horse to win a stakes race at 6 furlongs, 7 furlongs, a mile, mile 16th, mile 8th, mile and a quarter. We had Black Tie Affair at the farm, won the Breeders' Cup Classic. I mean, it's just an amazing group. And as I said, I wasn't starstruck around the movie people, but I'm completely starstruck around these animals. They're just unbelievable. And I'm in love with them. I just can't help it.
On average, there are 27,000 thoroughbred starters in New York State. But most people probably don't realize that there are three times as many standardbred starters in the state. Harness horses that may not receive the fame and notoriety of their thoroughbred cousins also need care after their racing days are over. Sunshine Horses in Central New York is a program specializing in standardbreds. Their motto is helping horses, helping people. This all-volunteer organization not only benefits the horses through retraining and adoption, it benefits the people who work with the animals.
We find a niche. People come here with no experience whatever with horses, and they may just do water buckets. We had a woman who was deathly afraid, and her doctor said, go to Sunshine, you know, and do it. Now she's actually up to grooming. So, you know, we do have that niche that we do help, you know, with veterans and youth and everything like that.
They're good therapy horses as well. They work with kids. They work well with kids. You know, all depending on the horse, but you just have to get to know the horse, and then you can figure out what the best thing for them is. And when we adopt the horses out, a lot of what we do is we talk to the person who's a potential adopter. What do you want? You know, what's your skill level? You know, we really try to match them up, because if for whatever reason it doesn't work, they're going to come back to us, and then we're going to find the right place for them. So it's our goal to find the right adopter. Whatever they're looking for, a standardbred can do it. It's just which standardbred.
Aftercare organizations like Sunshine also help the community by providing important social engagement to those who need it. Joan Wilding from Hutchings Psychiatric Center immediately recognized the benefit of having members of the community work with the horses at Sunshine.
They come for different reasons. It might be just socialization. It might be where you see people in a different light, where they have... they don't talk very much at all. They come here and they just kind of connect with the animals, and you just see them, and it's just, they blossom. It's been a wonderful program.
Racehorses have skill sets that are tailor-made for second careers. That's why it's important that owners, trainers, and all connections work together to make sure a horse is healthy and responsibly retired so that it has the opportunity to thrive in another line of work. Second careers can include serious work, such as working as police mounts, performance such as show and jump competitions, or recreation such as trail riding.
They're hunter, jumpers, they're great on the trails, they have such good ground manners, and that's a lot of that's from the track mostly. They, you know, they can do anything that you ask them to do. They're willing animals, you know, they can do anything.
In the end, all participants in the horse racing industry have a duty to look after these animals that provide us with so much entertainment and take steps to ensure that they have a safe and comfortable life both on and off the track.
If you're going to do something to a horse, make sure it's in the horse's best interest. And if you think that what you're going to do to that horse is in the horse's best interest, then go ahead and do it. But if it's not, don't. It's a very simple way to do it, but I think it's a good rule.
New York's horse racing is second to none because, as an industry, we know these horses that give their very best deserve our very best in return. Consider the horse's lifespan and take steps to learn about the resources available when getting into the racing game. Let's continue to be a model for the rest of the world and work together to make sure these athletes are treated with the best care for their entire lives. I'm Larry Colmus, and thanks for watching.
On the spot a little. Can you tell us a little bit about what went into making the video, what you're aiming for here on this, and what the use of the long form will be, and then what are you going to do to try to focus and hone that down into something that's not punitive for individuals that are going to be looking to check that box when they apply for their license or their renewal?
Sure. So since we announced this project about a year ago, it was slow moving through the winter. Obviously, a lot of facilities were unavailable for one reason or another. But once the weather broke, we had a very truncated schedule with the Office of Media Services, which is basically the state production company that does. Actually, they're doing the webcasting for us here today. This was all done in-house by New York State government. Myself and the production crew took 3 days, literally traveled to states of the various farms and facilities you see on the grounds, or in the video. We couldn't get to everyone. There's a number of facilities in New York State, TRF, Equine Advocates, and so forth, that we just did not have the time or the availability to get out and get all these places. But we wanted to get as broad of a spectrum as we could, including standardbreds. That's why you have Sunshine Horses is pretty prominently featured as well. So that was in the spring, and then it was a matter of going through and editing down everything and getting to what you have here, what you saw today, which is a rough cut. It does need to be shortened a little bit, I think. And certainly if people here have feedback when we're talking later, I'd love to hear it. And our goal is to make, like Rob said, two versions, one that's 5-6 minutes tops. That will be required viewing for anybody who's applying for a trainer's license or renewing a trainer's license or an owner's license and an assistant trainer's license, I believe. And then the longer form video, which again, not quite as long as what you just saw, but it kind of encapsulates the whole issue of aftercare and responsible horse ownership. We want to make that available to everybody. It'll live on our website, it'll be on YouTube for anybody to use. We're hoping that the tracks in New York State will show it in between races on their in-house simulcast feeds, or carry it on their simulcast feeds so that people across the country or across the world who are watching these races can see clips of that. It'll be available for you guys to all download to share with your friends and your networks. And, again, just kind of serve as a model to help get the word out about the great work that everybody here does, and to hopefully drive more resources and more attention to the issue of aftercare.
So. I appreciate that. As I mentioned, the next item that we wanted to talk about was some of the research that we've been attempting to undertake, but and that'll be done by, or presented by Mr. Knowlton. But before I turn it over to Jack, I'd be remiss if I didn't single out Fasig-Tipton Company for their generous allowance in affording us the ability to use this pavilion for today's event. Fasig-Tipton has been a long supporter of Thoroughbred Aftercare, pioneering a checkoff system that allows those using their services to directly benefit aftercare programs, and we're highly appreciative. Jack Knowlton is known to many people in the community here as the president of Empire Health Advisors, which is a healthcare consulting firm located in Saratoga Springs, but he's better known for his involvement in racing. His involvement in racing began in 1982 when he became a partner in his first standard bred. He's best known, however, as a founding member and the managing partner of Saratoga Stable, the owner of Funnyside, the New York-bred who won the 2003 Kentucky Derby and Preakness Stakes. Mr. Knowlton?
Thank you, Rob. It's a pleasure to be here for the second year. And first of all, I'd like to really thank the leadership of Rob Williams and the work that Lee Park has done to follow up last year's initial meeting. A lot of times these things occur and a lot of things are said and nothing happens. But as you can see, I think the video that Lee has worked on is just a tremendous achievement. And under Rob's leadership and the leadership of the Gaming Commission members, particularly Peter Machete, to put aftercare into a limelight. And hopefully it's going to continue to move forward. As Rob mentioned, and last year I did an update really on what we're trying to accomplish and understand what are the numbers, you know, what are the needs. And I think we're still kind of frustrated that we haven't been able to get where we would like to get. And one of the things that I would like to ask the audience during the freestanding time that everyone can have an opportunity to give feedback is ideas about really tracking and maybe on, you know, more of a timely basis where thoroughbreds go after they leave the racetrack.
Just hit to the right.
There you go. Okay. Last year, we did initiate some work with the Jockey Club, and they provided data on every New York thoroughbred that raced somewhere between 2010 and 2012 and did not race since. That ended up being a total of 3,894 thoroughbreds. They also told us the track that they last raced and the last trainer and owner of record. Commission staff have done follow-up to some degree successful, to a lot of degrees not successful, and we'll show you the data on where we are at this point in the follow-up. We did work with, even one more time, with the Jockey Club to find out, if we could, how many of the horses that had retired or that finished racing served as broodmares. And that's information we have this year for the first time. The ultimate goal really is to provide the thoroughbred industry of information on where the horses go after they leave the track, you know, how many have second careers, how many are shipped out of the country, how many have died, how many cannot be found. And again, we're hoping that this is going to, you know, give us some sense of the need. We continue to be in a situation where we hear that their funding needs, and we know that that's true. And how many horses are we really talking about? So, looking at the sex of the retirees, 1,907 mares, 1,634 geldings, and 353 intact males and ridgelings. Location of the last race, and this is not surprising. We shared this with you last year, but Finger Lakes accounted for about a third of the horses where they had their last race. And it's, some of those horses had careers at Finger Lakes, but a lot of horses started running at NIRA tracks and ended up running at Finger Lakes.
We've had the experience, I think probably most owners have, that horses that you hope are going to be successful in Naira Circuit aren't quite good enough, but yet they're sound and they love the race, and there is an opportunity to continue to race, and they'll go to Finger Lakes and then they'll retire from there. Aqueduct and Belmont account for about 20%, Saratoga only about 3%, and as you see, there are a number of tracks that go down to 1.5%, but about 20% are in other racetracks. So when we get to talk to about the data a little bit more, that's one of the real issues here is we have better luck knowing where the horses at Race in New York are, but when you get spread out throughout the country and in Canada as well, much more challenging. So the state of the last race for these horses, 58% was in New York, but about 42% was outside of New York. And that obviously gives us a lot of challenges in terms of, you know, finding out where they went. So the status of 3,894 New York-bred thoroughbreds, the known status at this point was 1,082, which is only 27.8%. Unknown, 2,812, 72.2%. So although we've been successful to some extent, what you're going to see is to a large extent, that is identifying the brood mares. 54% of those horses are brood mares and 29% deceased, 8.9% retired, 5.9% adopted. Now we know that the retired and adopted and second careers, those numbers are much higher, but we don't know what those numbers are, and that's going to be represent a continuing effort on the part of commission staff to see if we can, you know, get increased identification of those horses that, you know, have retirement, they have second careers, and hopefully we'll be able to shine even more light on where these horses have been. Location of the last race and the number of horses with a known status, Finger Lakes. We know where 25.1% of those horses are. Aqueduct, Belmont, and Saratoga, close to 50%, 43%, 43%, and 47%. So we have a pretty good handle on that. I mean, clearly not as good as we'd like. But my speculation would be that a lot of the brood mares that have been identified, they're coming from the Naira tracks because they're higher quality horses and they're the ones that are going to be used for breeding purposes. Just to show you the challenge that we face, 2,812, the status is unknown at this point. Those are represented by 900 different trainers and anywhere from one to one trainer. Finger Lakes had 93 horses on a list that was still unknown. So I think that, you know, that just gives you a flavor of the breadth of where these horses are when you think about how many different trainers are involved in these horses and trying to get the kind of information that we want. And we're also at a point where we're getting a little bit dated as well. So one of the things that I'd like to you know, throw out to the audience once again is any ideas you know, on a more current basis, an ongoing basis for tracking horses as they leave the racetrack and trying to really understand where they're going and what the additional need is beyond what we know today. Again, thank you for being here. Hopefully we will be able to follow up and provide further information going forward. But I'm just so pleased that, you know, the video that Rob has really been the leading force behind, and what Lee has done with the state folks is something that I'm hopeful is really going to move us forward as we try to do as much as we can for both the thoroughbreds and the standardbred retirees. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Jack. I think it just kind of underscores the problems that we've had in trying to just identify the scope of the problem. I mean, everyone has anecdotal information of what the problem is, but being able to get hard figures and identify where these horses are going is just proven to be a lot more difficult than we had believed. Before we open up the meeting to discussion, which I think is probably the most important element of what we'll be doing today, last year, I have an announcement. Last year, we announced that the commission was developing strategies to educate trainers on the use of risk factors and intervention strategies in an effort to reduce injuries. And we had announced a forthcoming rulemaking that would require annual continuing education for trainers that would likely encompass these materials and introduce new research regarding injury reduction. And I'm pleased to announce that the rulemaking will be published in the State Register within the next week or two, thus enabling, barring substantive content issues, adoption at the beginning of November. This will allow the state to begin requiring some continuing education for trainers beginning with calendar year 2015. Scott Palmer, the state equine medical director, has been working this past year with academics and with the Grayson Jockey Club Research Foundation to develop modules to educate trainers, and we're enthused that these new learning opportunities will assist trainers in better identifying health concerns and thus reducing equine injuries, which will benefit both them and benefit the horses as they enter into their second careers if we can get them out of racing with less injuries. At this time, I'd like to open up the meeting to discussion by attendees. As I mentioned last year, the issue of horse aftercare is not one to be resolved through government imposing moral requirements on the industry's participants. This is an issue that begs for self-help and for the industry to take leadership, and we've seen through NYTHA, for instance, and take leadership and set an example. As I mentioned, the commission has little ability to drive revenue to retirement programs, but we do have an ability to raise the profile on this subject matter. We want to help, and we'd like to hear any ideas for what we can do to assist your development or anything that you're doing in the retirement forum. And to that end, today, as I mentioned before, we have Commissioner Peter Machete with us, and I note that Commissioner Barry Sample has also joined us, but Mr. Machete has graciously agreed to help moderate and at least keep the flow of discussion going relative to this. Peter?
So last year I was here and we had the forum, and it was, very well attended, and I really liked what was said. And I said it last year, I'm a horse person, but I'm not a person who came from the racing industry. I mean, I ride my horses, I own them, but I'm a fan of racing. I really like racing. But I do think, and I was hearing Larry Combs say, in New York we have the best horses, we have the best tracks, you know, best racing. You would think then that we should probably have the best aftercare, right, and a program for the best aftercare. Because if we're that successful in that aspect of it, surely we can put our heads together and be successful in funding and making sure that at the end of their career, the horses are taken care of. I mean, when we first started, I attended meetings with Jack and Lee and Rob, and I was very enthusiastic. I'm saying, let's go. Let's get some legislation passed, and everybody's going to pay. You know, the breeder, the trainer, the jockey, everybody's got a piece, right? It goes along. Everybody gets a percentage. Well, if you're going to get a percentage and you're going to get some benefit from this, you got to pay to make sure that this athlete that's given you all this is taken care of afterwards. And so I'm thinking this is going to be easy because, you know, we'll know where the horses go and what we have to do and how many. And then they're looking at me like, look, you are a novice, because it is not that easy. And it's not. And it's almost so frustrating that you want to walk away because, you know, the horse that's bred in New York, but then ends up in Kentucky. Well, who's responsible for that? And how do we make sure that that horse gets
taken care of, or the horse that's bred in Kentucky that ends up in New York. And see, I had never thought about that. And so when you start thinking about all that stuff, this is a bit complicated. I think it's definitely doable, and I really think people need to step up. And Rob's right. Government's not going to do it. If we're going to look to the government, we're going to be sadly disappointed. It's just not going to happen. And the public is not going to want government to do it. They're going to say, look it, this is horse racing, right? It's majestic. There's all this money. Why should the public pay for it when the people in the industry are benefiting from it? So, and I think that's probably the only way to do it, and it probably has to start with the breeders, right, and the owners, and the trainers, and the jockeys. Everybody's getting a piece. So we need to design a system, and it's a business. Look, you don't want to cripple the business, but you need to design a system to get money, and then you got to figure out how to properly distribute it and who does that, and all that gets rather complicated. But I think everyone is working pretty hard to do that, and I think that effort has really been increased dramatically the last 2 or 3 years. And it wasn't that way. You remember we had that seminar, and the people that came here from Penn and from Suffolk Downs and from California were saying, there were years, nobody cared. End of the season, who cares? This horse is done. Whatever's going to happen to him, happens to him. And that's what we were trying to figure out. Where are the missing 2,900? You know, at one point, they were missing 6,000. So you think, that's probably not a good thing. So we've narrowed it down, and it's probably can be narrowed down more. And it's frustrating because that's a difficult process. And that's what's slowing getting a resolution. Because if you're going to say, all right, we need to raise money, well, how much money, right? How much money do we need to raise? Well, we need to know how many horses we need to take care of, right? And I know that it takes a lot of money. I mean, my horse is my responsibility. I retire my horse. He's retired now. He's still my responsibility. He still eats just as much as he did 5 years ago, right? And he always seems to come back from the paddock a little bit sore, lame. I said, how did that happen, right? You were fine when you went out there. You're a horse. You're out in the field. Behave. So that being said, look at we're all ears. If there are suggestions, and I gave this long little speech because for some, I think we think it's easy to do, and it's not. It's the right thing to do. It's a requirement, right? It's our obligation. We just got to figure out how to do it, and sooner rather than later. So if anybody has any questions or suggestions or even criticisms, we're all ears. Sure, we'll go here.
Hold on, wait.
As a point, one of the things that's important because we are webcasting this is we need you to talk into the microphones. That way people at home will be able to hear what you're doing or asking.
My name is Valerie Buck. I'm with Heck Naturally. I exercised horses for 28 years on the track at the highest level, and I've been taking a horse here and there off the track since I started in 1983 at Keystone Racetrack. I became more aware of the need for aftercare when I became friends with Diana Pikulski with the Thoroughbred Retirement Foundation. The jockey club is so diligent about getting the papers and the breeding and everything right on these horses when they're born, live coverage, all that kind of stuff. Why can't they be as diligent on the other end? I think it's their responsibility. You know, you go to the jockey club, they're registering all these horses that are coming in, but then they're like birds, they fly away, and they don't care where they go, and I think that's important, and I think that microchipping is coming into play. Is that correct? Does anybody know about microchipping these horses?
Yeah, we talked about
that. I think that's important because, you know, when these horses are signed out from the racetrack, you have a microchip, you scan them, and you have to have an address where the horse is going to. It's not rocket science to figure out where these horses are going.
Well, they're big animals. You can't hide them.
No.
It's not like a cat or a dog. Yeah.
Microchipping these horses and finding out where they're going, and I think it'll be an easier way to find them when they do hit the feedlots, the auction, kill pens, because a lot of times you can't get to a horse's face and read a tattoo if they've been abused, neglected, and you can't get near their face. You know, there's these things happen. But I think ultimately it's the jockey club's responsibility to be knowing where these horses are going. If they're going to register them and be so concerned about when they go into the paddock, they have to read their tattoo to make sure it's the right horse that's running in the race because money's behind it. Well, there's a life on the other end of that money, and they should be just as diligent on them going out as they are coming in. So I think going to the jockey club with this is part of the issue of figuring out where these horses are going when they're done racing. Just my opinion.
Yeah, no. The other thing I was thinking of, right, so they were talking about what's the last place the horse raced, right? So what happens at that point? Because I don't really know. Is that the horse goes back to the barn, the stables, and then something's got to happen with that horse, right? So at that point, the horse has an owner. The horse has a trainer. So the responsibility, you would think, should fall at that point on them to at least notify someone. We have to put a system in place. All right, this is a retired horse. Where's the horse going? And, you know, what are we doing about the horse? Instead of, you know, quietly the horse is gone one day and we don't know. So that's the difficulty we have tracking. So I don't think it would be too burdensome, do you, that the person that has the horse in it at least lets us know we've decided to retire the horse, so we put a requirement in, and then we have to have a data bank, right, where it goes to, and so we know, all right, this horse owned by this individual, trained by this individual, was retired on this date. Okay, so then, and a little bit of a blank space there, where'd the horse go? That certainly would make it easier to get a handle on. Someone else had a question?
Thank you. My name is Kathy Cimino. I'm the publisher of Equine Info Exchange. We're an international directory, and we also have the largest list of rehoming directories in the world. The equine industry is very underutilized as far as leveraging technology. What I'd like to offer for all these unfound horses is I could offer my services and the services of our website in order to try to help find and identify any of these missing horses, and I'm happy to do that. I'll provide the information to you, and if there's any way that I can better serve the equine industry, that would be great. I was a racehorse owner myself, and I'm very concerned about aftercare, and all the organizations represented in your video are on my website.
Oh, we are not adverse to help, believe me.
Yeah. Sure.
Yes?
I represent the standardbreds, I guess, in this room. And I commend you all on the amazing work you've done with Thoroughbreds. And if you could give me one or two steps as to how I can start this process with standardbreds, because we are so far, far behind you. We have most of our standardbreds disappear, and they mostly, we don't know where they go. They certainly don't go to horse shows or places that they can be seen and where the public can see what wonderful horses they are. They do go to the Amish, quite a few of them. And then when we get them from the Amish, they're pretty used up. I mean, these are champion horses that have had tendon injuries or chips in their knees, and they're not racing anymore. They hurt. And then they're sold. And they're sold for quite a bit of money. And to get a trainer to actually sign on the dotted line that he has sold his, 30 claimer for $3,000 at the end of his career, I don't think he's going to do that. But they do get good money for them, and the business is tough, probably tougher in the standardbreds than in the other. I'd love to have an accountability of how many horses go to the Amish. I'd love an accountability of how well the Amish take care of the horses. They are not an isolated community if they don't get regulated as far as how they take care of horses. And they end up in the kill pen, and we have taken out 7 this year just from the kill pen. So if you could direct me to the first baby step that you took to start all the tremendous organizations that you have going in the thoroughbred industry to help the standardbreds, I and the standardbreds would be greatly appreciated.
Yes.
Hi, Rick Violet from the Thoroughbred Horsemen's Association. Just a couple of points. Valerie, on the microchip idea is a great idea. We've been pushing the Jockey Club for, if it's not 5 years, it's 3 years. They're warming up to it. I mean, sales companies would like it. There are a lot of advantages to the microchip. I don't know how close they are. They're closer than they were last year. I don't know if it's going to... Okay, now I'm getting... It's mandatory next year. They're chipping the foals. So that's a huge step forward. As far as, you know, the last place of retirement, just a little bit of an explanation. When the horse runs his last race, whether it's Finger Lakes or New York, we don't always know they're retired that day, or even when you send them home, you send them to a farm, and they don't make it back, or and they might change custody, you sell them as a broodmare or whatever. So, I mean, it's very complicated. The microchip will help that immensely. You know, especially if they're going to get bred, they'll have a microchip identifying the mare and all of that. But it also underlines the importance of a group like the TAA, who accredits all the organizations they give grants to, and I think they gave $3 million this year. But they do a continuous inventory. Every year, all those organizations that they're giving money to, they know exactly where all those horses are quarterly. I don't think it's as soon as monthly, but they have an idea. So those horses they don't disappear. We need to expand programs like that. I'll be honest with you, we get getting mixed signals on. We really appreciate the Gaming Commission in jumping into this, having this forum, and be supportive. But at the same time, the Gaming Commission is looking to take away resources from us in Albany to fund equine research and testing that will directly limit what we could give to aftercare. It doesn't make sense. You get a quarter of our resources, of our budget, we're going to have to reduce a number of programs, not just the eyeglasses and the backstretch services that we provide, health care and dental work. And we provide mostly for the backstretch workers who can least afford to lose services like that. But we're looking to expand the aftercare stuff that we're doing. And if we lose money from our budget, it has to cost, whether it's the dental work or the aftercare. So I'm asking you to kind of take your foot off our throats, leave our budget alone, and we can get together as an industry with the standardbreds, with the racetrack, to find more funding that isn't going to cripple great initiatives like the aftercare.
Yeah, I don't know whose foot is on whose throat, to be honest with you, but I do know that I think the obligation needs to be spread out, the obligation to take the horse, and it starts with the breeder and an owner, right, and a trainer and a jockey and the race courses. And it should be a group effort. And I understand it's a business. And as I said, I'm a fan of the business, right? I'm a racing fan. But the obligation is still there. And I don't think, you know, when we're talking about what happens to the horse at the end, I don't think it should fall completely on the person that ends up with the horse, you know, in a claiming race, that the entire burden falls on them. I think it needs to be spread out across the spectrum because everyone is benefiting. So
no question about it.
I'm a trial lawyer by trade, so I'm a chain of custody guy, though. So when someone says we don't know what happens to the horse because you know they're out in the field and they're out the pasture, that seems inconsistent with me because I think there's a system where even if after runs at the Finger Lakes and you want to put them out the pasture for a little while and see how he or she does, and they don't recover, all right, so then what are you going to do? Is he going to go as a brood mare, or someone's going to pick him up, or, you know, he's going to be a pony? But if we have a system where you have to tell us what's happening and it's mandatory, that is probably helpful to all of us.
Right? And that we don't disagree on. It's just not, automatic.
Oh, I know it's complicated. Yeah.
And if we get that system in place, and again, the microchip would, I think, significantly aid that. But, and there's no question, and I appreciate the frankness from the young lady from the standardbred industry, we are light years from where we were 5 years ago. It has to keep improving. That's why I'm asking, don't take any money away so we can expand our program away.
Thank you. My name is Susan Wagner. I'm president of Equine Advocates, and thank you so much for holding this meeting again, and thank you, Jack, for presenting this meeting and last year's as well, and the State Racing Commission as well. I just wanted to say something quickly about the standardbreds. Our organization is multi-breed. We have thoroughbreds, standardbreds, and other breeds, and we recently took in a standardbred who was at a training center in Saratoga. 11 years old, had been a champion, and I was told that the Amish are all over that place. They take almost every horse, and it's a terrible fate for the standardbreds, and I hope that more attention can be placed on placing those horses, because it's really a tragedy. We have she's a 30-year-old standardbred mare who had raced and then became an Amish buggy horse. I bought her privately from the Amish to prevent her from ending up at the auction, which is where most of them go. A lot of the Amish, I see them, they drive in with one and they drive out with another. And it's a real problem. So I hope a lot more attention is given to the standardbreds. But with that said, I actually had written a statement because Lee Park had asked four questions that we answer, and I'm not going to read the whole thing, but there were a couple of things I just wanted to bring up if you would.
Sure.
Okay. With respect to new developments, this was question three, I see a much more sophisticated public who have questions that they want answered concerning equine protection issues. In this age of social media and public consciousness, I see these developments as important opportunities to show the public what racing and the horse industry in general is doing to end the slaughter of horses and ensure a humane fate for every horse born as a result of the industry. I want to say that it's truly inspiring to see all the wonderful ways aftercare programs have evolved over the years. But as nonprofit organizations, we can only do so much. I feel there are areas where the industry itself could do more to help, and I have a few recommendations that I think are important and respectfully ask be considered. I think it would be extremely helpful if funding was available to register the many unregistered thoroughbreds who have been and need to be rescued. At this time, the Thoroughbred Aftercare Alliance and some of the other breed-specific foundations fund registered thoroughbreds only. We have two unregistered thoroughbreds at the sanctuary, and as of now, they are not eligible for funding. It would be a huge help if they and others saved by organizations could become eligible. I also think the fact that New York Racing has a no-slaughter policy is a great step, but I also believe it can be easily circumvented. For that reason, I believe that all New York breds and thoroughbreds and standardbreds that race at New York State Racetrack should be accounted for to prevent them from ending up at slaughter. This would include, and I know this would take a law, I believe it was Jeff Gorell last year who brought this up, that additional ways to fund racehorse retirement could come from a percentage of the gross income from wagers and other forms of gambling. Improving and enhancing the existing identification procedures for horses exiting the racetracks, which I feel is essential. A wave goodbye by the trailer driver to the security guard is not sufficient. When a horse leaves, there should be documentation, including the name of the horse, the location where that animal is going, and contact information for the responsible party of that horse. And as Jack already mentioned, there are moves being made to try to track all the New York breds. I think that's great. And finally, I would propose that New York Racing establish an agency, say, for example, the Office of Humane Equine Affairs, funded by a percentage of the money wagered and all forms of gambling that provide profits to the racing industry. This agency would be run by caring individuals who would be responsible for surrendered horses who could no longer race and be kept in a barn of safe stalls. These horses would be evaluated by an outside team of veterinarians who could recommend retraining for sport or pleasure riding, etc., a retirement as a companion animal or in a sanctuary, etc., or humane euthanasia. And then the respective rescue groups could become involved accordingly depending on the types of aftercare programs they offer. We all know that some horses require extended turnout periods before being retrained and also receive treatment for injuries that are fixable before the retraining process begins. Now, there's not a lot of time to go into depth on this, but I would love to see some of them considered and would be happy to become involved. Thank you.
Susan, if you would be so kind as to provide me a copy of your statement, I'll make sure it's in the record. Thanks.
Hi. Rick Schosberg. I'm with NYTHA and with Take the Lead. To answer a couple of questions already, Peter, with regards to when a horse goes back to the barn, didn't run well, or maybe has an injury or something like that, sometimes, like Rick had said, sometimes they go to the farm to try and heal up, and sometimes they don't, you know, make it back to the races. We get plenty of calls from some of the farms that are handling horses like that through their owners and through their trainers. I think over the last 3 years, our exposure has gotten greatly increased on the backstretch. So when somebody, at least at the Naira tracks, or even if at Finger Lakes, they have a horse that has run at the Naira tracks, they know who to call. And I get plenty of emails and texts and phone calls, and so does Andy and so does Rick, about horses that are in need of aftercare. And I think the program is exemplary, and I think it's really growing. And I'd like to thank Rick for that. I mean, he really put the whole thing together, but kind of put Andy and I in the driver's seat and said, you guys run with it. But it is a situation where someone that has a horse in need can come and call us or text us or email us, and we're there, you know, sometimes within minutes, sometimes within hours, or if it's a day or two. And we can have the horses evaluated by our team. Like Susan suggested, a team of experts, a team of veterinarians, either on site or with regards to x-rays or ultrasounds. I sent a set of x-rays to Patty Hogan today for her evaluation with regards to aftercare. And we deal with, you know, obviously the accredited facilities in the area and in out of the area, new vocations in Kentucky, quite a few of our horses go there. There's a lot more to be done. I think a lot has been done, and I think the suggestions here with the group are well meant and well taken in. And I just wanted to let you know that we are working hard, and we need the funding to keep up our aftercare program, and Rick has discussed that. And the TAA has really, really, really been the driving force. And it's one of the only, if not the only, well, it's one of the only nationwide horse racing acts that actually works really well. Anyway, thanks.
Just a couple of points, Sue. Actually, horses travel with health certificates. Just so, and on the health certificate, when they leave the racetrack, you have to state exactly where the horse is going. Not just Kentucky, not just Alabama. You have to state the farm where the horse is traveling to. So there is some kind of paper trail that already exists, and maybe we can expand on that. But it's state law. They have to have a Coggins test. They have to have a veterinarian sign the health certificate. So I mean, and that's here. That's Finger Lakes Aqueduct. And I'm pretty sure it's at all the standard bred racetracks as well. So there is a starting point for tracking the horses. And, I mean, Rick touched on it. What you suggested, basically Andy and Rick are already doing. The veterinarians on the backside at their own cost come and examine, x-ray these horses when they're retired. They make a determination if they need surgery. He mentioned Patty Hogan. Patty Hogan this year did about $80,000 worth of free surgery on retired horses so they could have either a more comfortable life in absolute sanctuary, or if they were, after some time off, had second careers. That's enough. You heard enough of me.
So just a thought, Rick.
It may be on a certificate somewhere, but I know a lot of work went into trying to find out where these horses are, and there's still a lot of missing ones. So it clearly, whatever system is in place, is not working the way we need it to work. I understand there's, you know, there's a way, and hopefully there's a better way and an easier way and a more accurate way, because we got big holes as to where the horses have gone.
Yeah, I think the main element on that is we're playing catch-up from the horses in 2012. Once they leave the racetrack and they go to that farm, they don't stay at that farm necessarily. And when they transfer, there's no requirement. There's nobody that's taking care or taking that information. And that's been a real problem in trying to locate where these horses are. But from a forthgoing standpoint, obviously that's a first point of information if we start collecting the information at an earlier time period.
So I'll come back here, but Mayor, I want to give you a shot.
Thank you. Thank you. Good afternoon. I'm Mayor Joanne Yepsen, the mayor of Saratoga Springs, and we are very fortunate to have a racing city, and we take that very seriously. Obviously, we care deeply about our economy and all the racing that goes into our success, but we also care deeply and are passionate about this issue. And so I want to sort of echo what Rob said is, you know, the role of government may not be clear yet, but I just want to say as the mayor of the city, I am eager to partner. I am very eager to do what Rob said, and that's raise the profile of this issue. I think we can be a model city for many other cities around the country. And I want to thank the Gaming Commission and New York State for taking this seriously as well. And I want to be sure that NYTHA and the Breeders Association and all the nonprofits here, Jack, Nick, really get the attention they deserve, because everybody's doing such great work. And all working together and partnering is critical. So thanks for the video. I was thinking all sorts of ways that we might use that right here in the city. And we want to promote this aftercare issue. In fact, we've already done that this morning with a press conference, and with Naira's help, got the word out as well last year. And we have started a local coalition of a lot of the farms and the organizations that were featured in the film, because we feel, again, as you do, I think, by holding this summit 2 years in a row, that together we can be stronger and do a lot more and make a lot good, better impact in our region right here. So whatever we can do from City Hall, whatever we can do from Saratoga Springs, we want to do it, and we would also be looking for suggestions of ways that we can increase our visibility with the coalition. And many of the members are here today, and they will speak to you directly, I'm sure. So thank you.
Hi, my name is Tom Gallo, president of New York Thoroughbred Breeders, also managing partner of Parting Glass Racing. Now that chip technology is here, and it's pretty innocuous, it's very simple, it's very inexpensive, my suggestion would be to take it a step further. Rather than wait for this fall crop to be, you know, 2 and 3 years old and have to trace them, the Gaming Commission could take the state vets and implant a chip in every horse on the backstretch probably within 2 days. It takes about 5 minutes per horse. The vets already have the scanning technology. It's here, so why not use it? If you don't want to do existing horses that are racing now, every horse that gets tattooed, a new horse that hasn't started, a requirement for them to start would be, along with the tattoo, put a chip in. It takes about 3 or 4 minutes. If the state, you have state vets there, the Gaming Commission could, you know, fund this process. It's very inexpensive. You're only on one end of it, where you're just inserting the chip, and the chips are very inexpensive. They're very small. The vets would have the scanners, and then you can identify horses, and you can give these scanners to the border, to border agents, border patrol, and have them throughout the state. So at least you could, you know, monitor horses' movements within the state. And once they leave the state, and I think New York as a pioneer and as probably the best and most important racing in the country, would set an example for the rest of the country. And if New York starts it, then of course a lot of other jurisdictions would certainly take notice and start that also. Number two, I want to compliment you on the fact that you've made this video. It's a fabulous video. I also like the idea of showing it to trainers, but one step further is I would show it to owners. I would make it required for any managing member of a racing syndicate to see it and to make sure that all his fractional owners see it. The reason I say this is because, you know, we are in a modern era, and with this modern era of technology, we also have like immediate gratification. And a lot of the owners that get in these days aren't in it because of the love of the horse. Like in the old days, this was a sporting community. People raced horses because they loved them. They bred them, they raced them, they had their private trainers, and they raced them, and then they took care of them because they had the wherewithal to do it. This day and age, you know, you have people that want immediate gratification, and I get this a lot. So a person calls me to ask me, well, how do I get into your racing partnerships? I spend 5 minutes telling them the basics, and the question that I don't want to hear is, well, how do I get out? My answer to them is, don't get in. Because once you get in and the horse is your responsibility, in my racing partnership, I allow everybody to know that you don't own the horse till its last race. You own the horse until it's properly placed in an accredited retirement organization. So I think it's important that we educate new owners that are getting in and make them watch this video to show them that, you know, it's not, the end of the line is not the last race. The end of the line is when that horse is properly placed. So I commend you on the video, but I think we should expand the viewership to new owners getting in. And I think that's about it.
I apologize for being a little inarticulate, but the intention of the video is for owners and owner renewals. So it'll be for trainers, for trainer renewals, new owners and owner renewals. We're also looking at what's the appropriate level of even pushing that a little bit beyond that. But we want to have the right person being required to watch it. With regard to your other suggestion, we appreciate the suggestion. That's the whole purpose of what this meeting is for, is to hear from individuals who have thoughts, who have concepts of what we may be able to do. And we're more than happy to explore what we can do relative to chipping technology and what can be used to track horses.
Hey, Diana, can I get 1 second because that's a follow-up to Tom?
You guys.
Sorry. I'm Jeff Canizzo from the New York Breeders. I just wanted to add in some more details about the specifics of what was already mentioned. The Jockey Club offered new foals of this year, 2016, the ability to be microchipped. Next year in 2017, it's mandatory. So you don't have, it's not an opt-out program. It's mandatory. Every horse from here on forward will be microchipped, which will resolve all of the things that we're talking about from a tracking standpoint.
If I can interrupt real quickly, every thoroughbred at least.
Every thoroughbred.
There's still a large problem, a large concern relative to the other half of the industry.
That's very true. Very, very true. So we're talking about thoroughbreds. I am, anyways. That's a major part of what's happening. There's another thing that's involved that Tom was alluding to, too, is the equine passport, which is relevant to the health certificate. The Department of Ag and Markets here in the state of New York requires that all other livestock and different types of animals take part in this equine passport program, which is basically similar to a human's passport, but for animals. Horses can be a component of that as well, and it's attached to the microchip. So there's a lot of different tracking mechanisms that finally our industry is going to be a part of going forward that's certainly going to resolve some of the problems we're talking about here today. It's a measure of how we step backwards, like Tom was talking about, for horses that are obviously already born.
Thank you. I'm Diana Pikulski with the Thoroughbred Retirement Foundation, and we care for 840 horses every day. And most of them are not sound enough to go into second careers except careers in, therapy or our biggest program, which is the Second Chances program at the prisons. We do find, though, that sometimes after 5 years or 7 years that some of our horses do become sound. So we're continuously checking them, and we've had probably 5 horses in the past year go to police work, which is, not something that is so hard on them, as a show career or something, but it's a second career, and then they're being cared for by somebody else. So I think that's a good example, as well as the fact that a lot of the horses we're caring for their whole lives come from, the gentleman here as well. And it's a great marketing opportunity that racing should not forget about, that some of the horses that are retired, that they're leading a good life. That way the people who are there at the racetrack or the horse fans aren't thinking to themselves, what happens to all the ones that aren't sound enough to go on to something else? Well, they're doing something really good. And that also needs to be put into the funding mechanism. A lot of the funding mechanisms now give a one lump sum when you take a horse. Well, that, after a fairly short period of time, is used up, as you guys know. So I feel like the funding, no matter where it's coming from, A, needs to be tied to the horse so that, different horses require different amounts of funding, but every horse is as deserving as every other horse of some funding. And I think it's important that everybody who is involved in trying to find the funds and the new funds and develop the new funding systems is cognizant of the fact that we need new money. NYRA is, taking money out per start, and they're putting in mechanisms, but that's less money than NYRA used to give away to aftercare. So it's the same money that's being, rearranged, but it's not more money. There are more horses that need to be cared for. Every day there's more horses that need to be cared for. If you guys actually find the missing horses, that's going to be more horses that need to be cared for. So the funding mechanism should really be based on the horse. Whether it's when a horse is registered, that there's money put aside, and that money is then used when that horse is retired. Or maybe you have something that says if an owner finds a good home for a horse, the owner gets that money back themselves as an incentive for them to do that. But I just think it needs to be like, the Gaming Commission, horse racing is highly regulated, but the very creatures that are the essence of the game, they're not really regulated when they're not racing anymore, and it's not fair. It needs to be, everybody needs to be involved, including you guys, in how this is going to work. It's because it's becoming so important to the public as well. If you want the public, if you want, all the young girls who love horses to go to the racetrack, they have to feel good about it, and that's, that really needs to, we need to be doing the good work, doing more of the good work, and then really marketing it and showing people how all the good things that are happening. And my last comment is just on the microchips. I'm unclear as to how those are, I don't think they're microchipping at the borders, and I don't think they're microchipping at the slaughterhouses. So I'm just not sure how that's is going to, we have to figure out how we're going to use that microchip, that identification piece, to actually help the horses who are being, led by dishonest people.
I think part of it is, what we're trying to do is get a handle on it, and it relates to what you're talking about, cost, how many horses are out there, and then what degree of money is required, funding, to care for them. And it's very complicated, as you know, because you can have horse A, who has very few vet bills most of their life, and horse B, who it seems like the vet is out there, you know, every 4 weeks. So, and you're right, you know, ideally you would have almost like an annuity system, and they mentioned it, where each horse would have its own annuity. We're a long way from that, but I totally understand what you're saying. I mean, a lump sum, people don't fully appreciate how much it costs to take care of horses. It is very expensive. I mean, and, you know, people that have horses, we always say this, a lot of them, most of the regular folks, the horses eat before they do, right? I mean, and that's because it is so costly. So, but I mean, with the chip, we definitely, knowledge is power. It really is. So we got to get a better handle on that, and then we can hopefully utilize the chip in ways that are beneficial to everyone, the horses, the racing industry, and that the public in general will appreciate, because there is always a perception issue, right, with race horsing. Okay. Yeah.
So hi, I'm Jeff Carl. I'm a former jockey trainer. I'm actually one of the original inspectors for the Thoroughbred Aftercare Alliance. One thing that I've seen being out in the field as an inspector for the TAA, not only have I seen heartwarming things, Susan, Diana, Joanne, I mean, not only do they need funding, one of their biggest issues is they have limited space. They can only take so many horses. And I don't know who should take the helm on this or should be a cooperative thing, but somehow we need to raise awareness of farms that could be satellite farms. They don't necessarily have to apply and be full-fledged 501c3s. A lot of them don't want to. They can be, you know, rehab facilities. A lot of people take layups and stuff, but they might have a portion of their farm that they could allocate to be a satellite. And somehow, I don't know who should take the helm on this. It should be a cooperative thing. Maybe we could put ads in equine publications and get it out there. There's casual farmers that would love to have, you know, retired racehorses and get some kind of compensation for it. So I think some way we need to do a better job of getting awareness out, because as much funding as we can give to these people, we still need more space to put more horses.
So I think we had some.
Right here.
Sure.
Hi, Anna Ford with New Vocations. Just a little bit about New Vocations. Our mission is focuses on rehabbing, retraining, and rehoming both thoroughbreds and standardbreds, and we do it pretty much from the Midwest all the way up to New York and down to Gulfstream racetrack as well. And I just wanted to give a little bit of perspective from our seat here, because we're an organization that's kind of unique, where we take both thoroughbreds and standardbreds, and we've been doing it since 1992, so we're one of the oldest ones out there besides the TRF. And working with all of these different states, and we work with New York a lot, we're able to take in over 450 horses a year, which is a lot, and it's a lot more than any other groups, but it's just a drop in the bucket. However, with that number, I have to say, and with us working with all these different racetracks, New York is already leading the ship, I feel, in aftercare and how they're dealing with things. So I want to just bring some positive light to this discussion and say I think that these type of bringing the right people to the table is really, really good to make sure that we're not reinventing the wheel in different places, and that we're utilizing the resources and utilizing the systems that are already in place. Just to give you a little example, when we started working with Take the Lead, with NYTHA's Take the Lead program 4 or 5 years ago, we were only taking in about 40 horses from the New York racetracks a year. Now, last year in 2015, we took in over 120 horses. The only way we were able to triple that number was through their funding alone. That has been instrumental in us being able to do more for the New York horses and the racetracks, specifically with the NYRA horses, through that Take the Lead program. And not only is it funding that they're providing, but they're also providing boots on the ground.
I'm not going to touch it. So.
Not only the funding, but they're providing boots on the ground. One of the things that is so frustrating as an aftercare organization is, and it was mentioned in your video at Aikendale, you know, we're told one thing about a horse and it shows up and it's something completely different. You know, oh, it's sound, blah, 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 and then it comes and, yeah, it's sound in one leg. It's helpful to have that information before we get the horse. Well, with Take the Lead, they have vets here at each racetrack that go and look at these horses. We get ultrasounds, we get x-rays, we get a vet report on every single horse, which is huge, huge. And I believe they're all volunteering their time, which is great. And so when we get horses from NYTHA's program, we have a pretty good picture of what we're getting. We know if it needs to go to rehab for 8 months. We know if it needs to go have surgery. We know, and they help us with that. We know if it can go right into our training program. They also help organize the transportation to our facilities, which is huge. And so they provide even more than just the funding. So I just want to make sure that we don't overlook some of these systems that are already in place, which seem to be working really, really well. Do they need to be improved on? Absolutely. There's always going to be places that we can improve on. But I just wanted to say thank you to NYTHA and everything that they've done for the aftercare. And I think a lot of the aftercare programs that are represented here would say the same.
We have time for one more, I guess.
I'll be really quick, I promise. Dr. Kirby Wyckoff here. I am a researcher from Worcester State University in central Massachusetts, also a mental health clinician who does a lot of those equine-assisted services and research on human-animal interactions. Addition to that, I'm a member of Three Diamonds Farm, an active racing stable. We ran about 20 horses here at this meet. So I have a unique position to have one foot in both of these doors. I think what strikes me most about this conversation is that I was here in early September when Fasig-Tipton was having the sales for the New York Select Sale and the Premium Sale, and this was a full house. And if you look around, there are a lot of empty seats. I think this is part of our problem. Why is it that all of us came here today because we care about this issue, but we need to bring more people to the table? I think there are a number of systems and organizations in place that work really well, but until we get a better handle on how those systems can communicate with one another and how we can understand this need and systematically respond to it, we're going to continue to see empty seats, and I think that's part of where our focus needs to be attending to. Yeah.
Okay. All right.
Well, I think that's perfect to follow up on. You know, the one thing I was thinking of is I'm really preaching to the choir here. If you're here, it's because you have an interest and you want to do something. I think the important message is to get back into your respective communities and keep that conversation going and talking to individuals that may not be as knowledgeable or as interested as you are. But I think the main element, again, is keep that conversation going. We met last September. We're meeting today. I don't want to wait another year. I think there's opportunities to work on this this concern that the commission can assist with. And I'm really looking again for you guys to come up with ideas. We heard some good ideas today that we'll consider, and we'll see how we can work that into our regulatory scheme or otherwise, what else we might be able to do. But as you come up with these ideas or thoughts, you know, even if you think, well, it's a little harebrained, who knows? Spit them out to us. We're easily reachable. Lee and I are both are very reachable within our respective offices. Our emails are out there. We'll certainly circulate them, etc. But let's not wait for another year to see what else we can do. The video is a good start. The research is a good start. But we still got a long way to go. Again, I know I'm preaching to the choir on this. I really appreciate your attentions today. And look forward to hearing from you guys in the future. Thank you.
Thank you.